Okay, I'm Alon Rosen from IDC Herzliya. I'll be speaking for 6 hours in the next 1.5 days, teaching you about the foundations of zero knowledge. If you asked me 1 year ago if I would be speaking about zero knowledge to 30 people, I would have been happy. And now I'm looking at more than 150 people interested in the topic, which is unbelievable for people like me and Yuda and others that have been working on zero knowledge for almost 20 years. So I'm very happy for this occasion to share with you all the beautiful stuff that we've learned throughout the years. I'd like to thank Yuda and Yunit and Benny and all the organizers for setting up this beautiful framework, and let's begin. I'm going to assume very little about your background, by the way, because I see that it's a very heterogeneous crowd, and I don't really know what you know and what you don't know, so I'll start slowly and assume nothing, almost nothing. Except that you're intelligent people. Okay, so what are zero knowledge proofs? Let's get down to business. It's an interaction between two entities, the prover, always on the left side, and the verifier, always on the right side. I was just joking with Yuda that if people explain to us zero knowledge the other way around, if the prover is on the right-hand side, then we wouldn't understand anything. And what happens in this interaction is that the verifier gets convinced of the validity of an assertion. Of course, we'll define what this means. So there's a proposition, and the verifier gets convinced that the proposition is true. So far, you know, that's nothing new. And what's amazing about it is that this interaction reveals nothing beyond the fact that the proposition is true. And what does this mean? Let me already give you the definition of zero knowledge in words. It means that if the proposition is true, then any V star, any verifier that even deviates from the prescribed instruction of the protocol, we say that he might as well talk to himself, might as well gotten the information that the proposition is true and talk to himself. This is our way to say that he didn't learn anything from the interaction, and of course, we'll focus on this extensively. And what's amazing about this idea, which is really revolutionary, is that you can define what it means to be zero knowledge, what it means for knowledge not to be leaked, without defining what is knowledge. Okay, that's the brilliance of the definition. There's no need to define what is knowledge, which is a very difficult question philosophically. So you avoid it altogether. So whenever you see the definition of zero knowledge, keep in mind this fact. We're defining that no knowledge leaked without defining what knowledge is. Okay, this is the amazing thing. So let's start with an example, a popular example. I'm not a big fan of these toy examples, but I have no choice but to do it because Shafi told me I must. So we have the verifier now is standing close to us. We have perspective. The prover is standing far away, and the prover is trying to convince the verifier that he can distinguish two balls, okay, that is not colorblind. As far as the verifier is concerned, he's seeing two gray balls, and the prover claims he can distinguish the balls. So how does the protocol proceed? It proceeds in two rounds. When I say rounds, I mean messages. Okay, so that's one round, and that's another round. And what the verifier does, he tosses a private coin and decides whether to swap or not the balls. Okay, so he either swaps them or doesn't swap. Let's say he swapped. And then he sends over the balls to the prover. From the provers, and he asks the prover, did I swap or did I not swap the balls? From the prover's perspective, and I apologize to the colorblind amongst you, he can distinguish whether the ball is red or green, and he can tell, okay? So he can definitely tell that the balls were swapped in this case. So now he replies, and he tells the verifier, you swapped. The verifier is really surprised the prover succeeded, even though he might have been lucky, because with probability 1/2, the prover could have guessed. So what do? We repeat this protocol many times until the confidence of the verifier is increased overwhelmingly close to one. Now notice what happened in this proof. On the one hand, after we repeated, let's say 100 times, the verifier is really convinced that the prover can distinguish between the balls because he never failed. On the other hand, what did the verifier learn beyond the fact that the prover can distinguish? His view is just of the interaction. What does he see? He flips a bit, sends the result of this bit flip to the prover, and the prover always guesses correctly. This is something that the verifier might as well has done without the prover. Just flip a bit, tell yourself the bit, you're done. So that's a classical example of zero knowledge, because the verifier learned something. He learned that the prover can distinguish, but he might as well have simulated this interaction on his own. What we'll do next is, of course, we'll try to cast all of this in a more rich framework, a more general framework. We'll see different examples of zero-knowledge proof that have different properties, are much more general. So, but keep this example in mind, at least in the beginning. Okay, so what is zero-knowledge good for? Why are we all here, all excited about zero-knowledge besides the blockchain? So the first application is that I can prove that I know a secret without having to reveal it. That's the canonical example. So for instance, if Alice wants to identify herself to Bob, what does she do? She picks some random secret X and publishes f of X, where f is a hard-to-invert function, a function from which f of X it's hard to find X. And then she can prove to any Bob that she knows X in zero knowledge. This will convince Bob that she knows X, and X is something that nobody besides Alice can guess. And at the same time, it will not enable Bob to prove to anybody else that he knows X, because the only thing that Bob learned from the interaction is that Alice knows X. So this is the classical example. Of course, defining what exactly you need from the protocol for this to work, we need to work hard. It will take at least 2 or 3 hours of lectures. And then by the end of it, we'll find out that zero knowledge is actually not necessary for this. And we can do with something much weaker, and this will be one of the interesting realizations. We'll talk about it in a moment. Another very important application of zero knowledge is in protocol design. And what it does to protocol design, it essentially makes it possible to design protocols that are secure against malicious adversaries. So you want to protect your protocol against parties that want to extract as much knowledge as they can, and for this end, they're willing to go to great lengths. They're willing to cheat in very devious and surprising ways. And it's not clear how to even begin designing a protocol that is secure against such adversaries. And what zero knowledge does, it enables us to partition the design process into two parts. First, you design a protocol, assuming that parties follow the protocol. Okay, they actually do what they're supposed to do. And once you're done with that, which is in itself not a trivial task, now you can compile it using zero knowledge to protocols that are secure against arbitrary deviations from the protocol. And the way you do it is you run the original protocol in the model where you assume the parties follow and force them to prove in zero knowledge that they follow the protocol. Okay, so this is an amazing application of zero knowledge. And if you look from far enough, all applications of zero knowledge fall into this framework. And more generally, what it enables us to go, this is a general cryptographic framework, which is more general even than zero knowledge, it enables us to go from a model where we assume we have a trusted party that does whatever we assume it's supposed to do as prescribed, and we get a full-fledged cryptographic protocol from it using zero knowledge. So in some sense, zero knowledge is what enables us to go from a setting in which we trust into a setting in which we do not trust. Okay, this is the most general tool we have. Okay, so why zero knowledge? Why are we so excited about this notion of zero knowledge besides the cool name, the two words zero knowledge, which sounds amazing? So I would argue that it's a remarkable definition of framework, as is much of modern cryptography. As I try to argue, it's at the heart of protocol design and analysis. And looking at zero knowledge, you understand the basics of protocol. Okay, it's like a toy example, very clean, very elegant, to which you can cast all sorts of considerations that come up when you design protocols. So it's very useful to look at it. And why is that? It's because it's just at the right level of abstraction. So it's simple enough that we can talk about it in a winter school and understand it and study it and actually realize it. And on the other hand, it's if you prove that zero knowledge cannot do something, this extends to many other things. Okay, so it's simple enough to be inclusive and to show feasibility, and at the same time, you can actually show things are impossible in zero knowledge, and this will carry through to other cryptographic tasks. So it's just at the right level of abstraction. Just like, not unlike Turing machines. Okay, they capture all possible computations, and whatever they cannot do, nothing else can do. But I want to emphasize that we should not be too excited about zero knowledge. Crypto is not just about zero knowledge. There are more general things than zero knowledge. And all the time, we'll say zero knowledge, zero knowledge, zero knowledge throughout this week. Remember, the zero knowledge is just a tool. It's just a means to an end. There's nothing holy about zero knowledge. We'll try to emphasize this throughout the lectures. And we have many weaker definitions that do leak knowledge, just useless knowledge, which are useful. We'll talk about them: witness indistinguishability, witness hiding, non-interactive zero knowledge, which, like, strictly speaking, is not zero knowledge, even though it has the word zero knowledge in the name, but still very useful. Okay, so we don't need to be too philosophical. We need to be practical and always keep in mind that sometimes zero knowledge is an overkill. And another thing to keep in mind, and this is could be of interest of people in the audience that are interested in implementing zero knowledge, is that zero knowledge is wonderful in the sense that it enables us modular protocol design. We have this box, magic box. It does exactly what we want, leaks no more than that. We can actually implement a system that uses zero knowledge without even knowing the definition of zero knowledge, okay, without understanding anything about zero knowledge. I've seen people do that and build wonderful protocols. So in that sense, it's a very practical tool. But on the other hand, if you want to implement something, modularity is your enemy, okay? And you better understand the inner workings of the zero knowledge, and you should always get inside the protocol if you want to do things efficiently. And now, these days, we want to implement things efficiently. So it's important for us to understand the inner workings, not just the modular box that gives us this zero knowledge functionality. Okay, so enough of introductory words. Let's start. So we'll start with a more general notion than zero knowledge proofs. It's a proof system in general. And the first question is, what is a proof? And I'd like to have you pause for a second and think to yourselves, what is a proof? Maybe some members of the audience have a suggestion, have an idea. Have you ever asked yourself, what is a proof? I'm waiting for an answer, by the way. Don't be shy. We have all week. Yes? Sorry, I cannot hear. Whatever that convinces you, okay.
The proof is related to a verifier that such that the proof is a string of bits that when it serves an input to this black box, the verifier, then it outputs 0 or 1 according to.
Okay, so you gave us a functional definition of a proof. I'm trying to think more meta. Even more general than in the context of computation. In general, what is a proof? When we say proof, what do we mean? Yes?
A claim with evidence.
A claim with evidence. Okay, it's interesting that you give me these answers. Okay, a demonstration of whether something is true or not. Okay. Yes, okay, that's a mathematical proof. I'm talking even more general than that. More ideas, more suggestions? Okay, so I would say that in its most general form, a proof is just a method for establishing truth. If you're a person that cares about the truth, then a proof is a method by which we want to reach to the truth. We want to know what's true and what's false. And what is a proof, what is this method, actually depends on the context in which it's deployed. So you could have a proof in the legal framework where the truth is determined by a jury or by a judge. And this induces the notion of a proof, right? What you should argue in court in order to reach to the truth. And of course, the truth that you reach in court is not necessarily what a mathematician would consider to be true. You have authoritative proofs, where it's proof by authority. Some people in some regimes might live by this truth. You have scientific truth. Which is a different notion of truth. It's a theory that has not been refuted so far, and it is refutable in general. You have philosophical proofs, which I don't understand personally. And you have the most rigorous and strict notion of a proof, which is a mathematical proof, which we love so much. And this is a process that some of you mentioned in your answers, is this process where you start from the ground truth, from axioms, from undisputable facts, and by sequence of logical steps, you get to a proposition, which is an assertion that is either true or false. In this case, you better arrive to true assertions. You never want to start with true assumption and get to false assertions. And this process, traditionally, for thousands of years, since Euclid, at least since Euclid, if not before, has been considered as a very static process, in which a proof is written down, writing logical inferences step by step, they are verifiable step by step, and as long as the inferences are sound, do not lead from true to false, we believe the assertion that we set out to prove. And think for a second, this went on for thousands of years until in the mid-80s, two elements have been added to the notion of proof, which is probability of error. Okay, you're willing to accept a false statement with a small probability, and the notion of interaction. And this is what we'll be talking about from now on. So let's talk a bit more about proof systems in general. So you want to prove, in the context of computer science, you want to prove that some input, or instance X, belongs to a language. What is a language? A language is just a subset of finite strings. And you want to determine whether X is a member of this subset or not. So you can see you have this verifier on the right, and you have this string that the verifier gets as input. And I want you to notice that there's no prover here. Okay, so the classical proof, actually, to define what is a classical proof, you don't need to talk about the prover at all, and the verifier is what matters. And this is another thing I want to emphasize. The verifier is the most important entity in a proof. And this is also for people implementing protocols. All that matters is what the verifier does, at least for the soundness of the proof. Okay, so remember this, very important entity. And then you can think of L as this language, as the set of all string X, so that the verifier given X and the proof pi, outputs accept. So let's define what is a proof system. So a proof system for membership in a language L is an algorithm V, a central entity, the verifier, so that for any X, for any assertion, we have the property of completeness, that if X is in the language, then there exists a pi proof such that the verifier on input x and pi accepts. And soundness means that if x is not in the language, then all possible proofs that the verifier will read and verify will lead to rejection. So these are the two central properties of proofs. Now we fast forward 2000 years to the late 60s, and we realize that all we care about is about assertions that can be verified in our lifetime. Okay, we don't care about assertions that take a very long time to verify. And this leads us to the concept that efficient verification corresponds to polynomial time verification. Why polynomial time? It's a long story. To make it short, I'll just say that polynomial time is a very robust notion in measure of efficiency. It's closed under composition, and it empirically corresponds to what we can compute efficiently. So this is why we focus on polynomial time. There's nothing holy about polynomial time. Polynomial time is just a useful abstraction for us to develop our theory in. Okay, so this leads us to the famous NP proof system, which is a proof system that on top of having the completeness and soundness properties, views the verifier as an algorithm, an actual algorithm that performs verification steps, which has this efficiency requirement. Not only that we have completeness and soundness, but the verifier should be a machine that runs in polynomially many steps. And the running time of the verifier is measured in terms of the size of the instance X, or the size of the assertion. Okay, so we measure the running time in terms of size of the assertion. And what is polynomial time, just to be concrete? So polynomial in the size of x is x to the power of c for some fixed constancy. It is not dependent on the size of x. And it follows by definition that if the verifier is polynomial time and its running time is measured as a function of x, then also the proof must be of polynomial size, because in that time the verifier will not be able to read beyond that in the proof. So we might as well focus on only polynomially sized proofs. Good. Let's see some examples. I'll try throughout, whenever I give a definition, I'll try to give an example. So our first example is the following language. It's called the Boolean satisfiability. It consists of all Boolean formulas that have a satisfiable assignment. More concretely, sat is a set of all phi over n variables, w1 to wn, w for witness, this is an NP witness, such that there exists a w, an n-bit string of bits, true, false, so that if we apply phi to w, we get 1, or accept, or true. So sat is the set of all satisfiable formulas. And to prove that the formula is satisfiable is very easy. You just send the assignment, and then the verifier evaluates the assignment, the formula on the assignment, and sees if it evaluates to true or false. So this is a classic example of an NP language. You can, in polynomial time, verify the truth of the assertion. Finding a witness is a totally different business altogether. We'll talk about it in a second. But once you're given a witness, you can verify. And the amazing thing about SAT, which is really remarkable, is that every language in NP reduces to SAT. So if you want to prove something in NP, you can reduce it to a SAT instance and prove the SAT instance, and this will automatically translate to a proof to the original assertion. But this comes at a price, and the price is that this problem has no structure whatsoever, because think about it. If you can reduce any possible problem in NP to SAT, it has to include all sorts of problems, and it induced by this that it is an unstructured problem. And one artifact of this is that we don't know any efficient algorithm for deciding satisfiability, because it would have far-reaching implication to all problems in NP. And the best algorithm for satisfiability runs its time exponential in the number of variables. And I just want to mention that this is in the worst case. We don't know about the average case status of SAT. We don't know whether a random instance under some distribution will make the problem hard. But we do know that every algorithm has an instance on which it fails. We conjecture. We don't know, as far as we know. I want to emphasize here that the world that we're living in is a world of conjectures. We'll always be assuming that things are hard, even though we don't know if this is a fact. And we'll emphasize it throughout. Here's another example of the problem. We call it lean. It's solving linear equations. So you're given a matrix A and a vector B, and you want to know if there is a solution to the system of equation AW equals B. Again, to prove that the solution exists, just send the solution and then do matrix vector multiplication and see if it satisfies the system of linear equation. Notice that it's a very interesting problem that, it, like SAT, it has exponentially many solutions. Okay, it's a huge number of potential solutions. So just searching through them is not a good idea. It will take exponential time. But unlike SAT, it has this nice property that is structured. In particular, it's linear. Okay, and this implies, as a result of this structure, that solving the set of linear equations takes time between, sometime between n squared and n cubed, where n is the size of the input. So this number that you see here, 2.373, is a matrix multiplication exponent. This is the fastest algorithm that we know of to multiply two matrices, and this is the time that it takes, at least theoretically, to solve a system of linear equations. And this is polynomial in n. So here we have an instance of a problem in NP that not only can be verified efficiently, but also a solution can be found quickly. And this brings us to the class P, which is a subset of NP, where we identify efficiency with polynomial time. So L, the language L is in P. If there's a polynomial time algorithm, such that L is all strings that A accepts. No witness here. No need for an auxiliary proof here. So we have this class NP. On the one hand, we have SAT. On the other hand, we have linear equations. NP is just a subset of NP, of those problems in NP that not only they can be verified fast, but also a solution can be found quickly. SAT is in this very special subset of NP problems that we call NP-complete problems. And any problem that is NP-complete, all problems in NP reduce to it. And this will be useful later on. When we in our talks. And one side comment I want to make is that we want to allow adversaries and honest parties and everybody to toss coins, especially given that we're dealing with crypto and secrets are chosen at random. They need to be have entropy. So we'll need model algorithms as probabilistic algorithms. This gives rise to a class called BPP. And this is an extension of P. You can think of it as an extension of P, where these are all languages that can be decided correctly by probabilistic algorithms with a reasonable probability. So it's all languages that can be decided with error at most one-third. Error one-third means that on yes instance you will output reject with probability at most one-third and the other way around for no instances. Example number three, and then we're done with examples. This is the problem of quadratic residuosity modular composite. So QRN is the set of all x's such that x can be written as a square modulo n. So x equals w square modulo n. Again, this is a problem in an NP. X is in QRN, you just send the square root. And to verify, you just square and verify that it equals w square mod n. What's so special about quadratic residuosity? Just like a linear equation, it has a lot of structure. It's a different structure, but it has a lot of structure. In particular, the set of quadratic residues, mod n, is a subgroup of all elements with an inverse, of all units mod n. But nevertheless, if n is a composite, if n equals p times q, where p and q are of equal size, the best algorithm that we know of runs in times exponential in the cube root of n. And the other thing, interesting thing to point out is even the best average case algorithm runs this much. Okay, so this is a problem that we conjecture might be hard. At least it's a very useful and illustrative problem for our purposes. And we can conjecture that it's hard on the average. Okay, so it's sort of a cryptographic problem. Okay, so let's summarize what we've seen so far, which sets out things for the rest of the talk. So we said efficient verification is polytime verification. We saw three problems, a linear equation, quadratic residuosity, and SAT. And here is where each one of the three problems lies. And notice that quadratic residuosity lies somewhere in between P and NP complete. That's the only thing you need to keep in mind for now. Okay. Now we skip to a different question. So we saw these are all three problems that can where membership can be proved efficiently. What about proving non-membership? What about proving, given A and B, that there's no solution to the system of linear equations? This is a very interesting question. Suppose you have a blacklist on the blockchain, you want to prove that your money is not laundered money. How do you prove that it did not come from an illegitimate source? And try to think here about many potential sources. So for linear equations, it's easy. What do? You do it yourself. You just decide on your own in polynomial time. If you did not find a solution in polynomial time, then it does not exist. But then what about satisfiability and quadratic residuosity? The most naive proof is just sending over all potential witnesses and checking one by one that they don't satisfy the formula or that they are not square root of x. And there are exponentially many witnesses, both in the case of SAT and in the case of quadratic residuosity. So the naive proof is exponentially large. So now it's not clear how to efficiently verify a statement of non-membership. And this is where the brilliant idea of Goldwasser, Mikhail, and Rakov comes in. It allows us to prove such statements, and it does so by introducing randomness, probability of error, and interaction. And this is what we're going to talk about now. Interactive proofs. So let's see an example and then define interactive proofs. I'm going to show you an example for interactive proof of quadratic non-residuosity. You're given an x, and you want to prove that it is not a quadratic residue. It does not have a square root, a modulo n. And here I'm abusing notation, I'm writing the complement to quadratic residuosity. By this I mean all numbers mod n, all elements mod n that do not have a square root. So now we do introduce the notion of a prover. Okay, now we added the notion of the prover, and here is how the protocol proceeds. Keep in mind the protocol for the colon non-blindness with the two balls, same protocol. Okay, same idea. So what the verifier does, it picks a random bit, keeps it secret, and it picks a random element, mod n. And if the bit is equal zero, it sends a y squared, z equal y squared. And if the b equals one, it says z equals x times y squared. And I already want you to notice that in the first case, when b equals zero, what it sends is a quadratic residue, right? It's a random quadratic residue. And in the case where b equals one, what it sends, if x is a non-residue, then this is a non-residue, because it's a non-residue times a residue. But if x is a residue, then this is also a residue. Keep this in mind. Now, what does the prover do? He looks at z and decides whether it's a residue or not residue, and sends the answer to the verifier. So, if b prime of z, b prime is the algorithm that the prover applies to z. If z is a quadratic residue, b prime of z equals zero. It claims that it's a quadratic residue, and if z is a non-residue, then it sends one. And what does the verifier do? It checks that b prime equals b. This is exactly the same protocol as the balls. Okay, all the verifier checks that the bit that he got from the prover equals his own bit. Okay, so let's see why this is a proof according to our intuitive notion of what a proof is. So in terms of completeness, we want to argue that if x is not a quadratic residue, if the statement is true, then the prover can always convince the verifier. And this follows from what I told you. It follows from the fact that if b equals zero, then and x is a non-residue, then the message is a residue. And if b equals one, then the message is not residue, which means that the prover can always distinguish between b equals zero and b equals one, and he always convinces the verifier. Of course, proving this statement might take a long time to the prover, but we don't care about that. We don't measure the prover's running time for now. In terms of soundness, suppose that statement is false, which means that x is a quadratic residue. In this case, both when b equals zero and when b equals one, z is a quadratic residue. And not only it's a quadratic residue, it's a random quadratic residue. And not only it's a random quadratic residue, but it's independent of the bit b. So the view of the prover in this case is a random quadratic residue and no information about b. So what's the probability that the prover will manage to guess b in this case? It's one half. So for any p star, and here I introduce a new notion, which is p star. P star stands for a prover that potentially deviates from what it was supposed to do. It's trying to apply some strategy, some function, not necessarily the quadratic reciprocity function. No matter what the prover does, the probability over the bit b that the prover guesses b from z is one half. Okay, so with probability one half, the verifier got convinced that this is a quadratic non-residue. Okay, so this brings me to the notion of an iterative proof. Iterative proof is a protocol with two parties, a prover, verifier, they have a common input x, the claim is that x belongs to the language, they interact for k rounds. The messages sent by the verifier depend on its randomness, let's call it R, it's a polynomially long string. And at the end, the verifier looks at the message that he accepted, that he received, and decides whether he accepts the proof or rejects the proof. We want the verification to be efficient, so V is probabilistic polynomial time, PPT. And we let, now notice that whether the verifier accepts or not depends precisely on his random coins and the messages that he receives. So let us denote by the probability that PV accept X, this. It denotes the probability over the coin tosses of the verifier that the interaction between P and V in parentheses on common input X and verifier randomness R results in the verifier accepting the interaction. Okay, so this is our notation, probability that PV accepts. And here is a definition of an interactive proof, revolutionary definition that changed forever the notion of a proof after thousands of years of stagnation. So an interactive proof for a language L is a probabilistic algorithm V and an arbitrary function P, such that for any common input X, we have completeness and soundness. Completeness, if X is in the language, then the verifier accepts with probability at least 2/3. And soundness, if X is not in the language, then the probability of the verifier accepting is at most 1/3. The 2/3 and the 1/3 are just arbitrary constant. You can replace them with bounds C for completeness and S for soundness, as long as they are bounded away from 1/2 by 1 over polynomial. We will not get into this, but once this is guaranteed, you can repeat the proof system many times until you get overwhelming confidence in the truth of the statement. And I want to mention two things. One thing is that NP is a special case of this proof system. This is when completeness is 1 and soundness is 0. And the second one is that BPP is a special case. This is the case where there's no interaction whatsoever and the verifier decides on its own. So this is a strict generalization of these two notions. Okay, so you already saw that quadratic non-reciprocity belongs to this class, to IP. Can it be proved interactively? And this goes beyond what we envisioned could be proved, or at least could be verified efficiently. And this suggests that maybe IP goes beyond NP. I just want to say as a side remark that we already know, and we knew at the time even, that quadratic non-reciprocity can be proved in NP. Okay, we know that as a fact, but it serves as an illustrative example for our purposes. But what really establishes the power of interactive proof is that you can prove unsatisfiability interactively, and in fact, not only unsatisfiability, but you can actually prove that the number of satisfying assignment is a specific value using an interactive proof. So this is a theorem from 1990 that asserts that sharp sat can be proved interactively. Sharp sat means the problem of counting how many satisfying assignments a Boolean formula has. And shortly thereafter, it was proved that accurately the set of languages provable interactively, IP, equals to all languages that can be decided in polynomial space. Now, these are all complexity theoretic notions. They seem totally detached from reality. I just want to say as a side comment that I believe that even though they seem to be detached from reality, they are very relevant to practice, because in practice, you are going to be concerned with polynomial space. In practice, I told you, we don't care about polynomial versus non-polynomial. We do care about these concrete blow-ups. And many of the ideas that come into these protocols, this IP equals P space result, and even more so the Sharpie containing IP result, you will see these ideas this week towards the end, when Eli Ben Sasson, for instance, will talk about his TARCs. He's applying these ideas to get these notions. But I will not do that because we're talking about an introduction. Okay, so here's the power of IP. So this is the picture we saw with lin, qrn, and sat, and NP complete. This is coinp. This is all languages whose complement can be proved in NP, and for instance, unsatisfiability is coinp complete. And this is IP, the set of all languages that can be proved interactively. It contains both these sets and much more. And as we said, IP equals P space. That's all I have to say about interactive proofs as a background to zero knowledge. And now we're getting to business. Because not only it turns out that interactive proofs have this amazing power of being able to prove these new statements, but they enable us to prove them without leaking any extra information. This is a new property, an extra property, that is also given to us by the ability to interact and allow for error. So at last, zero knowledge. So remember the proof, the NP proof for quadratic reciprocity, you just send the square root, and you verify that W square equals X mod N. And I want to point out two things now. First of all, is that assuming that quadratic reciprocity takes exponential in n to the third time, generating the proof takes that much time. Super polynomial takes a long time. On the other hand, we have a gap from this to the time that is required to verify, which is quadratic. It's just squaring mod n. So V, this verifier that required the proof for quadratic is dotted, he got something for free. He got this proof for free because he may have not been able to find this proof on his own. Okay, so this proof does leak knowledge that effectively V could have not inferred by himself, at least if he ran for a limited amount of time. So now we want to define what does it mean that knowledge did not leak. So let's talk about some attempts. These are classical attempts. That's the first thing you do when you define security of encryption. And that's exactly the reasoning that you go through when you try to define zero knowledge. So the first attempt, which is very natural, is to require that V didn't learn the proof itself, the entire proof, the entire string. This is not zero knowledge. It does leak information. For instance, it could leak whether the first bit of the proof is 0 or 1. But I want to point out that sometimes it's good enough, and I'm going to show you an example where we could settle for this. Very interesting applications where we could settle for this. For instance, identification, signature scheme. This definition, good enough. But now we're trying to be more greedy. We'll require not only that you didn't learn the entire string, but you didn't learn any individual symbol. Still not good enough, because you could infer some information that is a function of these symbols. Okay? And this might be something that you really want to hide. Okay, suppose if it's a contract between an employer and an employee, this leaks whether the employee earns more than $10,000 or not per month, even though it's not explicitly written in the contract. Okay, so let's be even stricter and require that V didn't learn any information about W. That's still not good enough, because maybe you want to learn something outside of the context of W that might be useful for you. Suppose you have two databases and somehow related, and this auxiliary information leaked something you really didn't intend to leak. Which brings us to the ultimate definition. Not only didn't learn any information about W, you didn't learn any information whatsoever. Okay? Beyond the fact that X is in the language, which is, of course, what you want to convey. So you convey only one bit of information, which is that X is in the language, nothing else. So let's try and define what does it mean. Let's do it using the example from the previous slide. So when would we say that V did learn something? If following the interaction, he could compute something he couldn't have computed without the interaction. Right? So the interaction gave him something he couldn't have done without it. And this is the zero knowledge definition. Whatever is computed following the interaction could have been computed without it. Except, of course, the fact that X is in the language. And that's it. That's the essence of zero knowledge. So if you come out of this lecture and you could simulate whatever I said, it means that you didn't learn anything from me. Okay? That's what this means. Okay, so let's try at last to be a bit formal about the definition of zero knowledge. This is the crux of this lecture. So V's view, what is V's view on the interaction? It's his random coins, okay? And the messages that he received. We talked about that. And what we want to say is that for any X in the language, the view can be simulated. He can generate a distribution that looks like his random coins and the messages that he received jointly. So before we go to the formal definition, I just want to say a few words about what does this mean, both from a philosophical and a practical point of view. From a philosophical point of view, what this means is that V is given the information that X is in the language, but modulo this information, he might as well have talked to himself. Why? Because he could have simulated this view on his own. So that's from a high-level philosophical point of view. From a practical point of view, what does it mean? From a technical point of view, it means that if V could compute something from his view, something new, what we are saying is that the same thing he could compute by applying it to the simulation. So V of the view gives the same information as V of the simulation, which means that whatever V could compute following the interaction, he could have computed on his own by just simulating, without even talking to V. And this both from a philosophical and high level makes sense and captures what we mean, but also from a practical point of view, and we'll see it. You can think of it as a reduction. You claim that you learned something from this protocol, you could have done something new, something leaked, and I will reply to you, no, you didn't. Because I'll show you how you could have done it without the protocol, I'll show you the simulator. Just run on the simulator. So it's really a practical notion in this sense. Okay, visually you have this interaction, the common input, the randomness, he applies the function to the randomness and the message, and then he remembers that this protocol is zero knowledge, so he said, forget it, I'll just simulate. He forgets about the messages and simulates on his own. This is what happens pictorially. Okay, so let's define at last what we call honest verifier zero knowledge. Why do I call it honest verifier? Because in this definition, I'm going to assume that the verifier acts as prescribed, honestly. And notice that this in itself is already super interesting, and it's not clear how to achieve it, even if we assume that the verifier honestly follows the protocol. For instance, the quadratic reciprocity proof is not zero knowledge, assuming quadratic reciprocity is hard, even if the verifier is honest. So, to be fair, we will allow the simulator also to be probabilistic, not just the verifier, and we'll assume that efficient is not P, but BPP. We already talked about it. And here is the definition. GMR 85. An interactive proof for L, which means that it's complete and sound and errors and so on, we already learned it, is on top of it honest verifier zero knowledge if there exists a probabilistic polynomial time machine S, the simulator, so that for any X in the language, given the information that X is in the language, the distribution of the output of the simulator on input X, S of X, is exactly the same as the distribution of the view of the verifier, if I did talk with the prover. And what do I mean when I say the distribution is the same? Think of a set of strings that consist of the verifier randomness and potential messages of the prover. Every such string has the same probability weight both in the simulation and in the real interaction. This is what I mean. Without getting too much into formalities, we'll also talk about it in the next hour. That's the definition. Stare at it for the moment because that's the foundation of all we're going to talk about in the next 4 days. Okay? There exists a simulator that runs in probabilistic polynomial time so that for any X that is in the language, the distribution of the simulator is identical to the distribution of the interaction between the prover and the verifier. This is zero knowledge for you. All the rest is just bonus. Okay, just a few subtleties. I talk here about the verifier's view. I don't talk about his output, even though what I really care about is his output. It's what he could learn from the interaction. But notice that if he can I can simulate the view, I can simulate the output because I could just apply the verifier's function to the view and get the output. So simulating the view is even stronger than what we require because a simulator for the view implies a simulator for the output. So from this point on, when I write this, I mean the verifier's view, even though sometimes it's considered it denotes the verifier's output in the literature. What I'm saying is that it doesn't matter much. Just keeps our notation simpler. Okay, so the first thing you do when you get a cryptographic definition is you want to see that you're not fooling yourself. Okay, that you're not defining something that is easy to satisfy, but obviously leaks information, so let's at least look at a proof system that we know that presumably does leak information. This is the proof system for quadratic reciprocity, and let's see why it's not zero knowledge, according to our definition. So notice that for any X that is a quadratic residue, if the simulator wants to simulate perfectly the view, he must output, he must give a W that is a square root of X. Otherwise, verification will fail. And this is something that the real prover would have never caused the verifier to do. So for any X in quadratic residues, the simulator will send us a square root. Similarly, for any X that is not a quadratic residue, not similarly, differently, for any X that is not a quadratic residue, the simulator will not send us a square root. Why? Because there is no square root. It cannot send us a square root. But if we assume that quadratic reciprocity modulo a composite cannot be solved in probabilistic polynomial time, there must be somewhere where the simulator fails. Because otherwise, we could decide for every x whether it's a quadratic residue or quadratic non-residue, right? S would do that for us. If x is a quadratic residue, it will give us a square root. And if x is a quadratic residue, it will not give us a square root. But you assume there's no such machine, because quadratic reciprocity cannot be decided in probabilistic polynomial time. So it means that the simulator must give us some non-square root for x that is a quadratic residue. It must fail for x that is a quadratic residue. Otherwise, we could decide quadratic reciprocity using the simulator in polynomial time. So what does this mean? We mean that it gives us the negation of the definition of zero knowledge. An interactive proof is not zero knowledge if for any simulator that runs in polynomial time, there exists an yes instance, an accent in the language, so that the distribution is not the same. And this is exactly what's happening here, if you take a look at this. And this is exactly the negation of the definition of zero knowledge. And there's something about cryptographic definition that people that are not used to it have difficulties with, is these extra quantifiers, okay? Crypto has one extra quantifier over algorithms. Algorithms in themselves already have enough quantifiers. Crypto has one more. And negating them sometimes causes confusion. And if you're working with cryptographic definitions, you have to really be careful about negating quantifiers and about the logic. And you really have to stick to the definition. You can easily get confused. And this is one instance, a basic instance of this. Okay, so now let's see a zero-knowledge proof for quadratic reciprocity. We saw something that is not a zero-knowledge proof. Let's see our first super interesting zero-knowledge proof. So the prover claims that x is a quadratic residue, and let's assume he holds the square root w. He holds the w, so the w square equals x mod n. And here how the proof goes, it goes in three rounds. First, the prover sends a random r squared, independent of everything. Okay, this is just a random square mod n. This is what will enable the zero knowledge property of the protocol. Then the verifier sends a random bit as a challenge. If the bit is zero, the prover sends r, the square root of the first message. You can see that this obviously leaks no knowledge about the square root of x, right? This is just a random number independent of s. And the verifier checks that it's indeed the square root, that z square equals y. And if the bit equals one, then it says the witness times r, which again, on its own, is just a random number, because r is random. And we said quadratic residues are a subgroup. So multiplying by a random element in the subgroup is just permuting it randomly within the subgroup. And it checks again that z square equals what it's supposed to equal, in this case, x times y, the instance times the first message. And notice here, features of the protocol is that p is randomized and has auxiliary input. And what is the distribution of the verifier's view? It's its own randomness, b, and it's the message y, the first message, and the message z, the last message. And these three messages satisfy that z square equals x to the by. This is exactly what is induced by this verification condition. You can check it later. So this view is just a triplet y, b, and z, a random triplet, uniform triplet, that satisfies this constraint. So the claim is that it's an interactive proof, regardless of zero knowledge. Completeness, I'll let you verify on your own. This is the proof on the left, and now we want to prove soundness. Suppose we have a cheating prover, P star, that wants to fool the verifier. If X is a quadratic residue, X is a quadratic residue, and if and only if there exists a Y, so that both Y is a quadratic residue and XY is a quadratic residue, believe me, it's a fact. Okay? You have to verify it carefully, but it's a fact. And now suppose that the verifier accepts with probability strictly greater than 1/2. Okay, and think of no instances. Think of things that are not quadratic residue. What does this mean? It means that both these constraints is satisfied, z0 squared equal y, the first message equals y, and the second one, both of them are satisfied. Because otherwise, the probability would have been less than 1/2, smaller or equal than 1/2. The only way to make the verifier accept the probability strictly greater than 1/2 is to have both of these constraints satisfied. Otherwise, you will fail on one of them. So this means that both z0 squared and z1 squared satisfy the constraint. And this happens if and only if x was a quadratic residue according to what we saw above. So as soon as P star convinces the verifier probability greater than 1/2, we know that x must have been a quadratic residue. And this implies soundness. Okay, zero knowledge. Why is this zero knowledge? So on the left you have y, b, and z. And the distribution of a real interaction is random y, b, and z, so that z squared equals x to the b times y. I told you before, this is the view of the verifier and interaction. Now, how would you simulate such a thing? So the first thing to notice is that the simulator must have some advantage over the prover, right? It must be able to do something that the prover can do, or otherwise it could cheat. The prover could use the simulator to cheat the verifier. So there must be something that the simulator must do, it can do, that the prover cannot do. And what is it that the simulator can do and the prover cannot do? The simulator can reverse the error of time. It can generate the messages from the bottom up instead of top down. And notice that this is consistent with our intuition of why this proof is sound. The proof is sound is because when the prover sends the first message y, he has no idea what b is going to be. However, if he knows in advance what B is going to be, he can cheat as much as he wants, arbitrarily. And this is what the sneaky simulator is going to do. He's simply going to first sample Z, then sample a bit, and then solve for Y so that verification works. Okay? And notice that he gets a Y without knowing what it is, square root. This is the subtle point. And he gets the right distribution. Just pick the messages bottom up at random, so this only constraint of verification is satisfied. And this is possible by solving y equals z squared divided by x to the b. And you get the same distribution on both sides. That's it. Honest verifier, zero knowledge. So that's our first proposition. Quadratic residuosity can be proved in honest verifier, zero knowledge. We're going to take a break soon, but before that, I want to go through a malicious verifier. What if the verifier doesn't pick a random bit? And what does it mean that the verifier doesn't pick a random bit? It means that his message B, the second message, this one, is an arbitrary function applied to y, to the first message. In this case, not only that we need to simulate the view, generate y, b, and z that satisfy the constraint, but also b has to be this function of y. Okay, so it's a random y, b, and z such that verification holds, and b equals v star of y. So how do we do that? We exploit the fact that not only we can reverse the error of time, but we can do it more than once. Okay, we have patience. We'll try until we succeed. So you start off in the same way. You generate z, b, and y. But now what you do, you apply V star to Y and hope that its output equals B. If it doesn't, then you're dead. Your simulator failed, but if it does, then you're done. What do you do if you're dead? You repeat. How many attempts does it take? 1/(the probability that you failed. And the probability that you failed is 1/2, and the point is that in Y, there's no information about B. Can be argued that Y has no information about B, which means that the expected number of repetition is 2. Okay, because with probability 1/2, you will hit the B, no matter what it does. And then you get malicious verifier zero knowledge for quadratic residuosity, which brings us to the definition of malicious verifier zero knowledge, or perfect zero knowledge. An interactive proof is perfect zero knowledge if for any probabilistic polynomial time V star, And notice that in the simulation that we just saw, it's important that Vista runs in polynomial time because the running time of the simulator depends on the running time of the verifier because it runs it. So for any probabilistic polynomial time Vista, there exists a simulator so that for any x in the language, the distribution is the same, identical. And we have this proposition, quadratic velocity is in perfect zero knowledge. And I want to point out, well, actually, what we showed is something stronger. Okay, we put a burden on ourselves. Not only we saw that for any verifier V star there exists a simulator, we showed one simulator that works for all verifiers. This is called black box zero knowledge. We'll talk about it extensively down the line. Another thing that you should notice is that we allowed the simulator to act in expected polynomial time. Okay, with exponentially small probability, this simulator will run for a very long time. Okay, and this is a bit unfair. And there are ways around it. I'm just mentioning it, but I will not get into it. I just say that tomorrow we will see an amazing protocol, really mind-blowing protocol, where the simulator runs in strict polynomial time.